Good afternoon. Welcome to MF Corner. I am Sumaira Abdi. On the show today, first up, we'll talk about the new rules for riskometers that SEBI has introduced last evening. Radhika Gupta, MD and CEO of Edelweiss Asset Management Company, will join in to talk about that and their new Pharma Index Fund. A little later on the show, we'll also be answering some queries sent in by our viewers. We'll have Shweta Rajani of Anand Rathi Private Wealth Management doing that. But first up, I want to talk about these new rules that have been introduced by SEBI. Now, the riskometer used to already be in play, right? So there used to be a semicircle, almost like a rising sun, where you could see how much was the risk you were taking if you invested in a particular scheme. Now, what has happened first is that the scope itself has been expanded to make it more representative of risk, and therefore there will be a new very high category that will be in play from the 1st of January 2021. As well, risk will now be computed on a scheme-wise basis and not on a category-wise basis. So what this means is that different schemes of different mutual funds which fall under the same category will now have different levels of risk. So it all depends on where your fund manager is investing, and you will know exactly how risky that investment is. For debt funds, what used to happen is that duration funds had no criteria in terms of what's the credit quality they could invest in. Now that will come into play. Credit funds had no criteria in terms of the duration that they could invest in. Now that will get married as well. All debt funds will now have this newly introduced liquidity risk factors as well that they will have to now adhere to. So there will, you know, there's a grade scale which will be introduced of 1, 2, in some cases 6, 8, 9, in some cases 12, and on the basis of how risky or where that investment falls on that grade scale, there will be scores given to the underlying of each mutual fund, and a simple average of those scores will be taken to find out exactly what is the risk level of your fund. So likewise, this is for debt, for equity as well. Now, the thing to remember in equity is that the grade scale itself starts from 5. In debt, we had seen the grade scale starts from 1. So what does this mean is that invariably, equity schemes, irrespective of which category they come under, will go into the high and that newly introduced very high risk category. So as you can see that, you know, even if you're investing in large cap stocks, the minimum risk factor for equity funds is 5, and it exponentially multiplies as you go down, as well as, you know, the volatility of the stock that you have invested in, the impact cost of that. So the, you know, average of the last 3 months, etc., will be taken. And here as well, there are grade scales, and a simple average will be arrived at to find out what is the risk level of that fund. But all equity funds will end up moving into high, very high. They've also, you know, given down risk levels of several other categories. The other important thing for investors, and you know this will work really well, is that along with the portfolio disclosures, all of these disclosures will now have to be made. As well, the annual change in risk profile of a fund will now be available to all investors. So you'll be able to see whether your fund manager has started taking riskier bets, or conversely, has your fund manager become more conservative? Are they stable? So basically, you'll be able to know exactly how things have progressed and therefore be able to better judge what your investment or what the impact on your investment could be. Having said that, let me now invite Radhika Gupta, the MD and CEO of Edelweiss Asset Management. Radhika, you remember we spoke about this on the 16th of September as well, right, when we first had this news break. Now that the rules are official, do you see them being easily implemented? One, what will be the effectiveness, and especially, you know, when the entire equity basket moves into high, very high, will that sort of spook investors?
So I think, Sumaira, a couple of things. Firstly, this is a good step. I mean, anything that adds to investor transparency is a good step, and especially highlighting the fact that there is risk in fixed income, the credit risk and duration risk, because I don't think investors are cognizant that there is risk in fixed income as much as they should be. I think that is a good step. And I think if there is a circular, then every step will be taken to implement it. And the good news is that the circular is very detailed and very objective. So is it implementable? I think so. As far as effectiveness, and I think I said this on the 16th of September, I think the success of the circular is in how much investors and advisors look at those risk disclaimers. It's all good to have high risk and very high risk, but what does very high risk mean versus what does high risk mean? The old half sun used to exist too, but I don't know how much investors looked at it. So the urge is that investors actually look at it and spend less time looking at just the 1 year return statistic, which I believe they spend too much time on, and actually look at some of these disclosures that SEBI is putting out. If they do, you look at these disclosures, look at the annual change in risk and ask questions of their fund managers, I believe it can be a very useful tool.
Okay, now Radhika, let's talk about the NFO, right? Because first let me get the name right, because it's quite a mouthful. Edelweiss MSCI India Domestic and World Healthcare 45 Index Fund. This is an index fund, right? And we've seen a slew of NFOs come in for ETFs, now index fund, and of course this marks the entry of MSCI into India. Do you really think there is such a big future for at least thematic index funds or thematic ETFs? I mean, you know, isn't it too far away? Some of them have market share of just 0.1%, 0.2%. Is it worth your while?
So it's a good question, and I think our idea is to open up options. This is the first thematic index fund in the market. What has existed so far as market size, Sumera, if you look at the actively managed sectoral and thematic fund space, that's probably 80,000 to 90,000 crores. So is that a big market? Yes, I think that is a big market. And you know, in that category, the reason we chose to go passive, and for us this is also the launch of our equity passive business, is that in thematic funds, we do believe alpha generation is going to be tough. The universe is actually pretty narrow in terms of thematic funds for what a fund manager can select from, and you see that in the data. So that's one. And secondly, with an index fund and a passive approach, you can bring a lot to the table that an active fund cannot bring. You mentioned that the name is Indo Global. You know, it's very difficult for a fund manager sitting in India to pick global stocks. But with someone like MSCI and with the role of an index, I can actually give investors global exposure, which is very, very important in healthcare. I can make sure that the product is a lot more true to label. You know, you don't have that SEBI rule of going 20% outside the theme. So I think it's an efficient way for people to get exposure to thematic ideas. And, you know, we were talking to MSCI also yesterday, and thematic investing is increasing among retail investors, not just in India, but also in Asia. So people are looking to take exposure to secular themes in small bits. ETFs have existed, but you've also highlighted the challenges with ETFs in terms of DMAT account, etc. Hence, we thought the index fund route.
Okay, fair enough. I'll tell you, I have two problems with the, you know, one is with a thematic fund and the other with the index fund. With themes, the problem is that, you know, if I as a retail investor know that pharma is a big theme, so does my large cap fund manager, so does my mid cap fund manager, right? So am I not double doing what they are doing? The other issue is that, and you know, I'd love to hear what you think of it, is especially in the pharma space, you know, companies are besieged by these US FDA issues, sometimes they're the Indian regulators, UK regulators. Is an index fund therefore really the right way to approach pharma investing? I mean, shouldn't that require expertise from a fund manager to be able to deftly navigate these situations?
So your second question first on pharma investing, I think one is that it is a healthcare fund, it is not pharma. In fact, pharma is just one of the parts of the fund. Now we think that pharma, and this also touches on your first question, is a, it's not, when you think of thematic, it's not a narrow sector. It is actually a secular story, and it's a story that has done well in the last 6 months, but over the last 5 years, it has been an underperformer. You are right, a lot of Indian pharma companies have had issues with the US FDA. We believe that period is over. Some of the pricing challenges that existed in the US are also over. But keep in mind, our fund doesn't just cover pharma. So it covers US companies in India with subsidiaries like which are like FMCG in character, generics, it covers diagnostics, and it covers the whole API space. So 70% of the fund covers that space, and then 30% covers sort of the path-breaking research that is happening in biotechnology and pharma overseas. So I think that's the scope of the fund. It's not restricted to just Indian pharma, which we believe has also come out of some of its more challenging days. I think as far as the first question, which is thematic exposure too narrow and can you do it directly? I think it depends theme to theme. I would never say a theme, no matter what it is, should be 50% of your portfolio. It has to be a satellite allocation to your portfolio. But you know, if you take the actively managed fund example, it's fund manager to fund manager dependent. I mean, even now we see that pharma is 7 to 8% exposure of many, many actively managed funds. So if you do want to get a larger tactical tilt to pharma, this is a very efficient way to play that tilt. By the way, global pharma exposure will not be present in any of your actively managed funds today.
All right, Radhika, it's always a pleasure talking to you. Thanks very much and all the best with your NFO.
Thanks, Mira.
All right, with that, we'll take a very quick break. On the other side, we're going to be answering some of the queries that have been sent.